c'est en ce moment précis, alors que la France blessée, mais vaillante et debout,
a desperate Premier Paul Reynaud, with the Nazis flooding into Paris, hammering France into submission, turned to America and promised that France would fight on if our president would send help. Our generals, he said, are commanding battalions. Send us waves of planes and we shall hurl back the invader. France will never die. That's the Nazi band that Paul Goebbels rushed to the famous railroad carriage in the forest at Compiègne. Here, where the Franco-Prussian War ended in 1872, here across the same table where Marshal Foch humbled the Kaiser's generals in 1918, Adolf Hitler had his revenge in a humiliating French surrender.
Achtung, hier ist der Großdeutsche Rundfunk. Sie hören jetzt die soeben eingetroffenen ersten Rundfunkberichte vom Beginn der Verhandlungen über den Waffenstillstand mit Frankreich im Walde von Compiègne.
After the disaster in Norway, Britain's House of Commons held a post-mortem, which raged for 2 days and two nights. Jeers and insults flew like shrapnel across the room. And at the end of it all, Neville Chamberlain walked out alone, a beaten, broken man.
It was clear that at this critical moment in the war, what was needed was the formation of a government which would include members of the Labour and Liberal oppositions. His Majesty has now entrusted to my friend and colleague, Mr. Winston Churchill, the task of forming a new administration on a national basis.
I speak to you for the first time as Prime Minister in a solemn hour for the life of our country, of our empire, of our allies, and above all, of the cause of freedom.
Winston Churchill offered nothing but blood, tears, sweat, and toil. For years he sat in the House of Commons like the conscience of England, his warnings ignored, as the big clock above the Speaker's chair ticked off the wasted hours. Now the hour had come for him to mobilize the English language and send it into battle, a spearhead of hope for Britain and the world. We have joined together some of that Churchillian prose. It sustained, it lifted the hearts of an island people when they stood alone.
Find the armies and fleets of Britain and France, gather a group of shattered states and bludgeon great races, the Czechs, the Poles, the Norwegians, the Danes, the Dutch, the Belgians, upon all of whom the long night of barbarism will descend, unbroken even by a star of hope. Unless we conquer, as conquer we must, as conquer we shall.
June 18th. I can hear it now.
What General Vagon has called the Battle of France is over. The Battle of Britain is about to begin.
Hitler knows that he will have to break us in this island or lose the war. Let us therefore brace ourselves to our duty, and so bear ourselves that if the British Empire and its Commonwealths last for a thousand years, men will still say, this was their finest hour.
And from a bombed building in a burned-out city, where the bombers came at dusk and departed at dawn, came the voices of two princesses, Elizabeth and Margaret Rose, sending greetings to evacuated children.
My sister is by my side, and we are both going to say goodnight to you. Come on, Margaret,